survive! Oh my god!
I told you, man, those Koreans and their Terran play. Damn.
And my Murray is like, you know what, giving us the virtual finger and like, I'm out. No, no way, you didn't just defend that.
That
oh
was
wow,
nuts.
that was a rage quit. That's what that was. You could tell. Like that
well,
was like,
I mean,
that was a angry quit.
Yeah, I mean, he knew he was behind, and he's like, well, I went for an all in, it didn't work, and it just. A whole of, what was it like? It was two Reapers and one Marine and a bunch of SCVs and just some
well,
good micros and good
is
repair.
That he target fired at each of the units so he could one-shot them all, the Zerglings.
Yeah, yeah.
And then for each Zergling that moved out of place, he put another worker. But that depot, or that bunker, was so low. It was below, like, 15 health. If he'd have gotten one more shot off, like, saved one Baneling, that would have been GG. End of story. No way you could have recovered from that. Wow.
Oh, man. I almost centered my camera. No. Anyway, but yeah, no, that was it. Was a very tight match between the two. Just barely able to, or Apocalypse just barely able to hold Murray and his Ling Baneling all in off. And yeah, man, that was
wow.
It was a close one.
So, all right, we're going to go and see if we can find... I'm going to go in and peruse, as they might say. We're going to peruse the bracket. We're going to play a little bit of music in the background, and then we're going to go ahead and see what's up next. So, thank you, Mamuri. Thank you, Apocalypse. I'm going to go ahead and actually turn the in-game music off, because that always sounds weird to hear both sets of music at the same time. Let's do this. Let's find out who's in this bracket.
I mean, there's Fiasco and Minirazor. Are they playing?
Let's see here. We got Nystic and Dubious SC2. Fiasco. We have Blue and Cylindar. And then we just saw that. So Apocalypse advances and is the first person to move to the semis. And then we have Nystic and Dubious. So let's see here. Let's see if any of those peeps in chat. Seldenar looks like he's in chat. So, you know, we haven't seen him. I will see if we can cast him.
Yeah, we'll have to see if any of these players are not in their matches. It's always the fun part of online cups where you're like, hey guys.
Hey, hello! You're like begging for a match to cast.
Anybody want to wait for me, guys?
Yeah, I know. So how about this? How about you hit up Nystic and Dubious SC2? And I'll ask for Fiasco and Minirazor.
Okay.
Let's see if either one of them are there.
Mystic is set to busy, so he's probably.
So they probably are in it. And it looks like.
Was it
Dubious? And it looks like actually. No, Seldenar is still there. It says. What's the SC2 logo? That means if you're in a game.
Yeah, or in a lobby, or a game lobby. So.
Alright, so Fiasco. I think so, but I can't tell if you're in lobby or in the game. Does a red SC2 logo mean that you're actually in? I think that means you're actually in game.
Yeah, I mean, it depends on a setting. You can set it so that you're set to busy.
All right, I'll do this.
You do Yu Meng.
All right, here you go.
Beer, though. It's a problem.
So while we're talking, I'm going to talk about my problems. It's going to be computer therapy for Mivic, okay? So here's the deal. So I had like stream issues where like my PC would constantly crash when I would stream. It doesn't do it necessarily when I do StarCraft, but it seems like when I do the games that really push my system, like that are graphical heavy. Let's see. What happened was that I have an overclock that's just like beyond insane. So it's like 3.4 gigahertz or 3.5 gigahertz is the SoC of my processor, and I'm running at 4.8. So I realized, or I learned that when you overclock your processor, you actually have to slow down your memory a bit. So I have like what, 2166 memory or 2133 memory in my computer. So I like to run at full speed. So I do. Well, apparently that may not be compatible. So I backed it off a little and went to 1866. So I changed the XMP profile, and I'm hoping for stability from that. Cross my fingers, hope to not crash. So we're not gonna play that song again. Pause. We're gonna try. Where's the other one? We'll try something. We'll go back to the other one. Sorry, it's all right. Where is? There it is. All right. I'm gonna flip back. I'm trying to like eventually get like a copy of like a lot of the Monster Cat songs so I can just create a playlist and have them play so I don't have to like use YouTube and eat bandwidth.
Yeah.
But otherwise, I usually use Monster Cat. You guys are free to use that, by the way. It's actually one of the Twitch-approved streams where you can literally just play music, and it usually doesn't get muted. I had one rare instance where they muted me, but I think that was a fluke. So, anyway. Nidic, tell these people where they can find you and why they would want to find you and all that good stuff.
So I'm not sure why you'd want to find me, but... I mean, I do some StarCraft stuff. When I have time, I do StarCraft stuff. Right now, it's mostly just hosting the Midwest Cup, which you've talked about a little bit before. So mm-hmm. That's a tournament that happens every other month. It's pretty fun. I do want to try and move into doing a little bit more stuff. But yeah, turns out having an adult life keeps you a little busy as well.
No, it doesn't. There's no such thing as an adult life. Quit yeah. Acting like you're grown up, man.
I know, I'm sitting in my bedroom wearing a Robin Hood hat, so I don't, you know.
That's really where, happening, guys. And I'm wearing a sombrero in my dining room. So yep. I mean, I'm pretty certain that the two of us are never gonna be married anytime soon. I mean, that's just how it's gonna happen.
So if you really want to find me, I'm on Twitter at Nivex706. Same as Twitch, it's twitch.tv/Nivex706. Those are probably the best two ways to find me. I guess, yeah, I do stream some other stuff on the side, like, it's just real casual stuff on the side whenever I have time and feel like streaming. I don't know, just chilling out. So, yeah. I don't know, that's what I do, I suppose.
Yeah, and my name is DJ Spectre. I do cast the Sunday Open here quite often, but I also have I also do the Wednesday Skill Cup for ESL, which is where it's bronze, silver, gold in one tournament, and then the other side you have the platinum, diamond. But I also have my own weekly show that I do called Thirsty Thursdays, where I play some StarCraft, I play some other video games, and I usually have criteria within the video game that says, hey, if I die, or if I die so many times, or if I'm playing a racing game, like my car flips on its roof or something, I'll do a shot or a drink or whatever the chat determines. So that takes place at 8 p.m. Eastern Time every Thursday. However, the exception being this week, there's a possibility I may have a Thirsty Tuesday, just because I won't be here for Thirsty Thursday because I will be out of the country for a week.
It's a Tipsy Tuesday?
You know what? I may have to change it to Tipsy Tuesday because... Well, I still have to go to work on Wednesday, but like my work day on Wednesday is going to be kind of like a I don't give a fuck mode, because it's like when it's the day before a vacation, like you just don't care. You're kind of like, what are you going to do? Fire me? Whatever. I'm already going on vacation. You're going to pay me for that time anyway. You know?
You're like, you want me to do something for you tomorrow? Well, too bad.
Yeah, you're like, yeah. Guess what? You know that upgrade you wanted? Here's the finger, you know?
clear my calendar. I know. Yeah. That's kind of like, yeah, I mean, me too. I mean, I have this 1 week of work, but then the next 2 weeks I'm out, and so it's like, all right, just finish stuff up, and then off I go.
All right, so I'm going to see. I'm looking through the chat. I still don't see anyone new in the chat. I mean, Memuri and Apocalypse are still there, but it looks like that match still hasn't... Apocalypse does not have an opponent yet, according to the brackets. So let me verify that. Yeah, Apocalypse is still waiting on Selendar and Blue... and it looks like the other semifinal is still waiting on the pairings of Nystic versus Dubious SC2 and Fiasco versus Mini Razor. So once we have either one of those matches into a game 3 that we can cast, or they move on to the semifinal, then we will have something to cast, because I will jump all over that the way a fat cake does on chocolate cake, all right?
So should I get out the should I get the Christmas tree costume?
You know what? You might as well. How long is it going to take? I mean, it's going to take a significant amount of time.
like in my closet.
Yes, we gotta see this.
All right, we'll see if the batteries still work in that bad boy. But
all right.
Time to retire the other hat. All right. Oh man, look at that! And I found $20.
You found your Christmas costume?
No, it's on the floor.
Oh.
Because you were like earlier today when you were like, make it rain, and I was like, nah, man, this is all I got. $20 bill.
But I sent you with the stickers.
Dude, I ain't got time to pick that up. Anyway, yeah. Time to be. I don't know what this counts as. Am I being some sort of. Am I like
whatever, a camp? I don't know. Like, normally you have to have, like what is it, the 100th follower, and then you do a cosplay for me? Like, what is this?
I don't know. Why am I. This is. You guys are getting this.
Do it. Who cares? Do it. You had a beer. You're feeling confident. Roll with it, bro. I know. He can't even hear what I said because he just got off his headphones. Sup, son? Oh my god, he's actually doing this. I'm gonna make this much, much bigger here.
So,
by the
I don't
way,
exactly
I
know
made,
how I'm
I just
gonna
made your camera much off. Bigger than mine because we want to witness god. The suit.
How do I?
Just put it on over what you're wearing, and then you gotta put the hat
all
on
right,
because it
gonna
goes with that too, right? The hat goes with that, right?
Oh man, it's Robin Hood. All right, we're
doesn't
gonna. We're
it
gonna
would look hysterical. Put the hat on with that. Just do
I
it.
Feel like. Alright, we're gonna turn off the camera for now, just to, in case of any sort of a
wardrobe malfunction?
Yeah, just to make sure. I'll be back in a sec.
Alright. We'll see him shortly here. In the meantime, we'll just leave that doing whatever it does. We're gonna wait for some games here. We're gonna go ahead and look here. See if there's anyone in the chat that is able to be casted. I don't see anyone that's available. I do see people. I do see people that are in game, so I think we're gonna have to wait. I'm sorry for the delay. We're just waiting on the semifinals to be determined. Looks like we've got one semifinalist that we need four, obviously. So real quick here, just to give you guys an idea, I'm gonna go ahead and can I shrink this down a little? Maybe more. Oh, that's really. Oh, that'll work. Okay. Maybe that'll work? Maybe? That's not gonna work. Oh, hold on, maybe. I'm an Imnard. We'll do this. Alright, here we go. So I'm gonna add this so you guys can see this. And by the way, I've got the world's. I apologize. I'm gonna have, the world's, worst, stream. But here is what we're looking at right now for semifinals. So let me enlarge this so you guys can possibly see it. You guys probably can't really see this very well. But what we're looking at is, so we just casted this match down here. And that put Apocalypse here. We're waiting on his opponent to finish up here. And then we're waiting on this one to finish up here. And then this one up here. And that's how we're waiting on right now for that to finish. Let me return my browser to its normally scheduled 100% size. And we're also waiting for Mr. Kevin to change into a Christmas tree. If you think I'm crazy, I'm not. The sombrero is actually carried over from previous cast, so I apologize, ESL, but... we're just having some fun. He was wearing a Robin Hood. Kevin was wearing. Are you still there?
All right.
Are you there?
All right.
I gotta see.
All right, there we go. There it is.
You know, don't you move the chair back? Move the mic out all of the right. way. Stand up. We gotta see this crazy thing.
I'm the beautiful Christmas tree.
You
Why
are. Look at this, guys. I'm maximizing him. This is what you get to see on DJ Spectre stream.
Hold up. The lights fucking work.
Scoot back.
Get out of here.
Scoot back. We need to see the whole thing. Is it a dress?
Oh, it just, I mean, I have, well, I swear I have pants on.
Nice! Alright, so you're dressed in a Christmas tree, now put the hat on.
It doesn't.
It looks perfect!
Dude. Oh, my lights. They.
Are they not working?
Work.
Is the battery
Wait.
Dead?
No, they work.
Oh, they
Hold
do?
Up.
I'm trying to maximize this so we can see this. Oh!
Boom, boys.
Awesome! Right. That is awesome. By the way, FYI, this is Christmas in July.
Oh, hell yeah.
How you like
I
this?
I thought I could get into Blink.
How do you like me now? Oh, it looks like Blue actually might be out of his match now, so I'm going to go and ask him if he's ready for his... he just
Blink
left. No, it looks like Blue might have gotten beat. Blue might have been beat. Where is... So it looks like maybe Solendar advances. Hold on, let's see here. No, Blue did not. No. Whoa, who just joined? No, I take that back. There is no update on this, man. Where is not Selendar? Yeah, Selendar. Sorry, guys. We are waiting for a semifinal here of sorts. Look at that. How do you guys like that? See?
We got Christmas trees, though.
How do you like that? You see DJ stream, and I deliver. This is what you get to watch. Now, I'm covering it up because Nivek is dressed as a fucking Christmas tree. So, that's what you get. And we're casting the ESL America's Open number 25. I would point downward, but he's kind of filling the screen with his blinking Christmas light costume. This is dope. I almost should put a bandana on my mouth just to fulfill this. I sent Blue a message. He, I believe, is still in game. Let's see who else is here. All right, where's the other song? We're gonna do. What is the name of this? This is called.
I think Mini Razor might be done with his set.
Oh really? Oh let me. Oh immediately. Good. Oh here, hold on. Blue just messaged me. Also, hang on.
Gosh, watching the delayed broadcast of this, I can't handle it.
All right, looks like we're gonna cast Blue game two. All right, invite. All right, so it looks like we're gonna go into Blue versus. It's gonna be Blue versus Seldenar. So we have a Seldentar, sorry. So we have a. I will suggest you to the game. And you guys get to listen to this old ass song here. So this is game two. Looks like it's gonna be on Cactus Valley. It is gonna be a pink Protoss versus a blue Zerg. Yes, it's not a pink Zerg. By the way, are you ready to go, Nivek?
Yeah, I'm good. I'm blinking.
You're blinking. All right, so we're gonna go ahead and minimize this so we can see my semi-attractive face. If you compare my face to like a cliff side somewhere. So anyway, gonna go ahead and stop the music. We're gonna go ahead and hit number 5 to go ahead and switch the transition. This should be full screen. It's not full screen. Full screen. Okay. Full screen the third time. Oh, you know it's on the loading screen. There we go. We're good now. All right, so let me get the music in the game going. Boom. Boomity boom boom boom. All right. Starting in the upper left-hand corner after an extended break, we have our pink Protoss player. It's Seldentar.
And down in the bottom right, we've seen a number of his games today, getting a good couple of wins, is our blue Zerg, Blue. Oh, man. Actually, he's blue.
Oh my god, the inception is real.
Do you know who was... So it's game two, right? Mm-hmm. Do you know who took the first game?
No, I'll... Let's see if I can ask. I don't actually know who... Oh, shoot. You know what? I can find out. Hold on. You know what? I can't. I closed the chat window, so I can't ask Blue. I'm not sure who actually took this series. So you know what? This is a O-O for us. I'm not sure who took this. Let me. And I'm an observer, so I can't actually ask the players. So by the way, if anyone knows or can ask the admin who took the first game in this series between Blue and Seldentar, please let us know and let us know in the chat. Game one in Blue versus Seldentar. There it is. Please let me know. Sorry, I went like full idiot on this. So my mistake, guys.
Yeah, that's alright. At the end of the day, I mean, not... Well, I don't know. We can see. Sometimes it determines like whether or not a player plays a little more aggressively or a little bit safer or tries to do a different strategy that maybe didn't work out the first game or something like that. So there's... But regardless, it'll still be good games to watch even if we... We don't know what the result of the first match was.
Yeah, and so far both players are doing very standard stuff. I mean, we see Hatch first, probably going to be, where's the drone's going to go out and make it to base. He's going to make it to base, so he make it to base. Meanwhile, the Protoss, Seldentar, who we've not casted, and in fact, I've never casted Seldentar, so by the way, welcome to the ESL. He goes ahead and does a standard. He does Gateway and Gas, so this is looking like, you know, a standard Gateway opening. I mean, you could do a 4-gate out of this, but the 4-gate is kind of not the meta anymore. Mainly because it's very much an all-in, with a heavy reinforce if you can pull it off. So, I mean, but this is fairly standard. We're going to see an early warp gate, or not an early warp gate, we're going to see a properly timed warp gate, we're going to see a zealot to plug whatever hole's available, and the Overlord Scout gets it, so that we don't have to worry about, let's see here. Looks like the scout happened for both players around the same time.
Mm-hmm. Blue went for kind of an interesting, I think Blue did some, like, extractor tricked zerglings, so that's why he was up at 20 out of 18 supply, and getting out a good number of zerglings to try and pressure Seldentar right away. I guess it kind of makes sense because I don't know though, this mothership core coming out, I mean, it'll eventually shut down the zerglings, and with a little bit of, you know, a little bit of micro by Seldentar to make sure that Zealot doesn't really die, then it gets pushed away pretty easily. Mm-hmm. So maybe
could
not.
Could you do me a favor? Respond in the chat to Nikki B. Red's statement. It's not a statement. It's like a question statement.
Sure.
By the way, anyway, so Nikki B. Red, just we're gonna type it out just so people who can only see the chat and maybe not listening to us, so maybe they're muting it, maybe they're at work, don't have headphones. No, we did not see the series. We did see a PVZ earlier, but it was not Seldentar. It was another Protoss player whose name I forget because I'm terrible at this sort of thing.
You should bring up the player
yes,
name.
Yes. Sorry, I'm I'm forever alone. You know, you can always trace Blue's thing in the bracket back. You know what? I should probably do that just so I get the correct name. Where is the bracketu? Where's the bracketu? You know who it was? We saw. Sorry, it was Greenert. That's who we saw. Who was the Protoss that we watched? That was who we saw.
It was Greenert. The Terran.
Yeah, I thought we saw PVZ. I don't know why I thought we saw PVZ instead of a ZVT.
We did, but I don't remember who it was. it's like I forget these things instantly.
Well, you know, I see so many players, and I'm trying to remember how I casted them, when I casted them, if I casted them. You know, it gets a little bonkers in the StarCrafting. So what do you think? What do you want to see Blue do to take the series? What should he do? What would you like him to do?
Let me think. So, well, he's got some, like, questionable gas going on. It's not so bad. I mean, obviously going for roaches. As far as what I'd like him to do, I mean, as the eye in the sky, the ultimate map pack that we've got going on right here.
The ultimate legal map hacker.
Well, yeah. I think, like, I mean, in this sort of scenario, like, Ling Hydra could be quite good against what Seldentar is doing right now. Seldentar is not really teching up a whole lot. We're not seeing, like, a robotics facility. We're not really seeing... There's the Twilight Council, finally. But yeah, I mean, Ling Hydra, even against the Twilight Council opener, can be extremely strong, just because there's not... You know, it's still a ways away from Storm, still a ways away from Colossus, but right now we've got a couple of sentries and a couple of Zealots trying to do some work, but they get pushed back by the few queens and handful of roaches. So Blue's staying pretty safe. I was a little bit unsure of his first actions with, like, the few zerglings that were pretty ineffective. But right now it looks like he's taking a decent place in this game. And if he macros up a little bit, gets a few more drones, saturates his third base, suddenly he's in a real great spot to actually just sort of do whatever he wants.
Yeah, especially so if he's able to. Up here, he definitely goes ahead and takes the roaches. He's got the advantage. I mean, the sentries don't have enough energy. I mean, no, I take that back. They do. They can force field off and sort of segment this, but he's saving the energy for the bigger push, which here's a slightly bigger push. You've got the zerglings pushing in. And, you know, I mean, he's just trying to, like, get back and
front. Oh, the pylon! Toast's ability to make units.
Yeah, Blue's doing really well to not overcommit right now. Like, he knows that a good force field. This is a save it. But he knows that, like, a good force field will really just kind of wreck this army. So if he can kill off some of these buildings, then he's in a great spot. He can just kind of back up. And he's continuing to pressure this, or rather stop Seldentar from taking a third base. It's Cactus Valley, it's kind of a tough map to really get your third base on. Like, once you actually fortify it, it's not too bad. But good force fields out of Seldentar, though, to trap these roaches in here. So he's going to get real cleaned up. Blue's going to try and maybe pick off a couple sentries is your best case scenario here. And Seldentar showing us some great micro to actually pull those back and keep him all alive quite nicely.
Oh, yeah, good force fields, but he's got to go right past the roaches, so he does lose two.
Yeah, but those were the first two sentries lost, and that was a really long fight, so not too bad. But again, yeah, we've got Blue just slow roaches, just continuing to overpower.
Yeah, and the thing is, like, this is just a lot of roaches. So one gateway goes down. He now has three pylons to make sure that one gateway forever stays powered, so we can reinforce. But I mean, it's just a waiting game here. I mean, these sentries are very low on energy. This is not a scenario you want to take. He's only got one stalker. He's got observer. Congratulations him. But more sentries?
Yeah, I think Seldentar is in a little bit of a panicked situation right now. I mean, you can see he's got a whole lot of money, and when you're panicking, it's hard to decide what in the hell are you supposed to do. So then you end up kind of freezing up and not really doing anything, which is certainly not the right answer here. We see some of these roaches get up into the main base, and they're targeting down just these sentries to get rid of that force field count, make the follow-up push even stronger. And we're seeing a really big supply lead just continuing to be furthered by Blue.
Yeah, and he loses another gateway. He's down now. He does have five gateways total. He's got what's the other one? He does have two more being made, and it actually looks like through the miracle of OP toss, I mean, he can potentially stabilize because he does have photon overcharge going down, but he has pushed back. But there is a slow but steady reinforcement of Blue. Until these gateways get up and running, he's going to be hard-pressed to stop this. And what he really needs to do is he needs to make Zealots, because that's what destroys Hydrants. They just simply do not have the DPS versus Zealots to really hold this off, I don't think.
Well, I mean, it's just like Seldentar is in a hard spot because he kept having to remake sentries to try and feel safe. But when you keep remaking sentries, you're not getting, you know, you're not getting your blink, you're not getting your plus one. I mean, he's made a forge and a Templar Archives and hasn't done anything with them yet. That's obviously not according to plan.
Yeah.
And so he's just in quite the pickle.
And he's also behind the supply by nearly 50. I mean, even the army supply is kind of whacked out.
Yeah, and so maybe feeling like he's just got to go all in right now. I mean, I'm that kind of makes sense as to why you would just stop the blink, or not even start the blink, or plus one attack researching.
And you know, he does have plus one. I mean, and you know, Blue does not have any upgrades.
I didn't even notice that big protest. Never mind, I'm an idiot.
Plus one is actually for Seldentar. I mean, good, like, forward is going ahead and trying to pick off these Hylas. I mean, that's what he's doing. There just aren't enough, Protoss units here. I mean, he does have a pylon here to warp in reinforcements, and the force fields are keeping it at bay. He does do a warp in of several more stalkers, so it will help against the roach count. But right now, it looks like Blue is just going to be like, you know what, screw it. I sense that something's over here. He's going to break down these rocks. He's going to take out this the reinforce here. And I think he's gonna try to circumvent this base. I mean, even with the loss of his fourth, I mean, like, Blue still has, he's still got a one base advantage over Seldentar. And this is not an engagement he wants to take. Like, coming down the ramp into this forest, there aren't very many sentries. They do happen to have very little energy, but there's just too many Zerg units here, and Seldentar has to retreat, or he's gonna literally lose everything.
I feel bad that I totally missed that plus one attack and blink actually came down. Whatever. but yeah, still a really big army supply lead for Blue, and it's not stopping anytime soon with such a big economic advantage as well. I mean, Seldentar is getting good trades right now. I mean, he's great force fields to funnel in those Hydras, and kind of an overcommitment by Blue. And But if he just keeps waiting it out, keeps baiting out some force fields, eventually he should be able to, at the very least, starve out his opponent. You know, like, that's... You can play the waiting game, and if you're four bases against two, it's only a matter of time.
Mm-hmm. And absolutely, the thing is that he's reestablished his fourth on the far side of the map. So, like, literally, you can't just easily take it out. I mean, there's a small concave or pincer attack. The stop is in order to move on. There is a lot you can do. The force fields do hold out the partial, the part of the pincer attack. But unfortunately, hunters actually do great against stalkers, and they are just picking this army apart. Pass the force fields, more stalkers are reinforcing. Oh! The late forward actually hold him off. Well done. It saves the immortal by doing so, which is just brilliant.
Yeah, I think in these fights, Blue's kind of been fighting against the amount of time it takes to try and reinforce your army. He had a lot of army supply, but not all of it in the same place, and you know, you're just not quite able to fight the way that you want to when you're in that position.
Yeah, I mean, and now Mutas are on the field. This is going to cause a problem because he's going to have to put a few extra stalkers or cannons or something in his base. I mean, you can see that he's trying to pick some away, but there's four Mutalists moving to the base, and here's the engagement that I think most people are interested in. The Blink Micro is actually very, very, very good by Selvitar. Great way to segue with the army with the force fields. He manages to great force fields, but there's just so many Hydras coming out. Like, he reinforces instantly. Like, for whatever he loses, he reinforces. There is a 63 unit difference in supply. The Stormblade's flooding in, the Stalker and the Micro. Like, I don't know what else to say to him. I mean, this is just a dire situation for Selvitar.
Yeah, I mean, it's a fight that's... it's just trying to hold on to the match through the use of force fields, and really it's... Yeah, it's a limited resources. That resource in that energy that eventually Blue's able to run out and you know, eventually just kind of run over Selvitar. I mean, very well controlled by Selvitar. I just think the first push out by Blue kind of crippled him a lot by taking out a couple of those gateways and really kind of messing with his build and just not able to let Selvitar get on the rhythm that he really wanted to be on. And then Blue continued that aggression the whole game.
A request from Nystic to actually cast his game next, but it looks like he went into game.
Okay.
On my recommendation, I did suggest him, like, look, don't hold the tournament up because you want to be casted. We will do game two if he's available. I will see, because it looks like that series might have been won. Let's see here. Let's make sure. I want to confirm with Blue. Was that a 2-0 in your favor? In the meantime, I will let Nystic know. That's not.
What?
Hold on. So, okay, that was a 1-1. I guess Blue tied that series up. All right. Reinvite for game three. Game three. There we go. So, no, that actually turned out to be a 1-1. So actually, I guess Selvitar actually took the first game, and Blue tied it up. So let's do it. I'm waiting for the invite from them, but I don't see it yet. Maybe Selvitar is kind of like, you know, F those guys streaming me. I don't know. But welcome to the stream, by the way, everyone. I want to give a few random shout-outs to people who haven't viewed the stream. Beastie Korean Stoner, or no, Beat by Korean Stoner. I love that name. That's awesome. Go ahead and, you know, if you guys are out there, give me a shout. Give Nivik706 a shout. You can go ahead and it's just the word Kevin backwards and then 706 at the end. So go ahead and give him a follow if you'd like. Looks like Blue has invited me, but he has not invited everyone else. And I am not doing a 1v1 versus Blue because I will get storm wrecked.
For glory!
For glory!
Man, this like costume's hot.
Like warm? It's because it's got electricity running through it. What are you expecting?
My goddamn fire hazard right now.
You know what the thing is? Don't fart, you might ignite yourself. You know what I mean? All right, give me 1 second. I'm gonna go fill out my Mexican attire with a Mexican beard because I don't have any actual Mexican leather attire. So, We're gonna go ahead and drink this Mexican beer called the Mexican Tecate. All right, we are casters already. Here it is. You declined the lobby invitation.
Oh my god.
You dumbass.
Fuck me.
I think you're focusing on your battery pack and not.
Yeah, man.
God.
I've checked my.
Kevin, I can't take you
social
anywhere.
Social media and shit.
I know. Like, that's the other thing. It's like, so, like, for casters, you're like, you gotta check social media, you gotta check. Like, that's all. It's like Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, like, Twitch itself. You gotta check, like, your various websites. Like if you do Twitch alerts or, like, follow alerts or.
And I just haven't done anything today except for sit at a computer and do StarCraft stuff.
It's okay. You know what? We're both nerds. We like this. This is just how we roll, you and I.
Oh.
Like, if we had to do actual work, like, whatever.
What do you mean? I do actual work, just
no,
not
don't.
On the weekends.
No, you don't.
Get out of here.
Just stop. All right, we will pause that music, go in here, hit number one. That should be that button. There we go. And by the way, I'll remember to put the names up the first time. Watch this. Right as the game starts. Oh, the production tab open. Look at that. Oh, and you know what's funny? My achievement. Well, it looks like Battle.net finally went fully sideways. I'm going to end up losing my ass when we come out of this. So, whatever it's worth. All right.
As long as you stay in the game while it's going on.
Oh, if I crash out, we're borked.
Cool.
Alright. So, in the lower right hand corner, the guy who had the pressure and the screws put to him by the Zerg player, still holding in there. He's still got a chance to win. This series is only 1-1. It's Seldentar.
And up in the top right hand side of Moodlight Madness, we have our blue Zerg. If he wins this one, he gets the wonderful
semifinal.
privilege of being wrecked against Apocalypse, perhaps. It is our blue Zerg blue.
All right. So, what do you think, blue? Based on what we saw out of the match, out of Seldentar, I'm gonna say it, Seldentar. How could blue follow this up? Should he do the same build? Should he try something different? Do you think Seldentar could potentially read it? Because, I mean, he seemed like he had very good unit control during those engagements. He just couldn't get his economy strong enough to get Colossus tech. So what do you think? What can he do? What can blue do to close this out?
Yeah, I think, like, yeah, I mean, you said it pretty well that, I mean, Seldentar had really great, I mean, with what he was working with, he had real great force fields, really good efficiency in you know the smaller army that he was working with, and so I can certainly see where it's become a 1-1 game, because I could see if Seldentar really gets on the ball, then he can certainly make it quite the game. But for blue, I mean, it, like last game, it kind of worked out because he caught Seldentar on the wrong foot and was able to kind of mess up his economy, mess up his game plan at an early point in time in the game, which really snowballs quite a bit at times.
Mm-hmm.
But this game, I mean, with Seldentar going for Forge Fast Expand, I mean, that's getting real safe here. He knows he's not going to be picked off by some sort of silly, like, you know, 7 Roach Push or something or some,
yes.
You know, some little gimmick to take out some of his tech. I mean, I think blue, at this point, he's got to identify it and say, okay, I need to get my... I mean, his spawning pool is done, and now he just needs to expand, like, a lot. He needs to really macro up, because a Forge Fast Expand doesn't really have a lot of offensive potential for quite a while. And I think, honestly, Moonlight Madness with this... It's a little... I mean, it's a weird map with all these rocks and such,
yeah.
And kind of pseudo-backdoor...
Well, you know what's crazy? You mentioned that, and that's actually a good point. So the back rocks here off the natural, or off the main, I've actually, personally sent Banshees and have collapsed that and then cut off all the queens from a Zerg player. So that does become a strategic advantage. However, we're not going to get to that point because Zerglings heading cross-map.
Thinking about it, but they could kill that probe. If this probe needs to make a pylon.
Yeah, he does. He doesn't see it. Does he make the pylon?
Oh!
No! No! Another Cannon is forced to do things that are now granted. The cannon is going to do some work. He doesn't have to pull the other probes to do it. He really needs to send one over there, and he does. He does actually send. I'm going to try to actually zoom out here so we can see this whole fight. But, like, you've got Zerglings fighting, like, not pylons. Zerglings fighting probes, and the pylon goes down. Wow, that was a lot more complicated to say than I planned out in my head.
Yeah, I mean, this gives a good... I mean, this gives some... maybe not good options to Blue, but he gets good information out of this. He forces Seldentar to take probes off of mining. Blue's doing the right thing by not actually engaging these probes because, don't get caught. It's better. You're not going to win the fight against that many probes, but it's good to pick off one or two to make sure they
like he's
stop.
Doing now. Yeah.
They got to stop mining, stop them from mining, make them try and follow those Zerglings around. And the whole time he's getting scouting information on Seldentar during this whole period. A couple more Zerglings, but it's time to play Ring Around the Rosie with the Zealot.
It's like all like melee all day, all the time. Let's go, you know?
Yeah, so I mean, at this point in time, Blue can be really happy with how many probed kills we got going on. We got 5 workers killed by Blue. So taking a nice worker advantage, as well as getting a great scout on his opponent, whereas Seldentar, if I take a look at his vision, I mean, he's seen that there's a hatchery. That's about it. So.
And you know what? That comes standard. By the way, that standard equipment on the Zerg base is a hatchery.
Yeah, and Blue this whole time, even getting a scout into the main, so able to see, well, not really a whole lot of anything, but... He sees the cybernetics go researching, I guess. I mean, there's not a lot of crazy things that you can do with the Forge Masters super early.
And Seldentar actually has no way out of his base other than breaking these back rocks here out of his third. So, like...
Yeah, true.
This is just a wacky situation where he's like... He had to make all this tech and these structures, right? But he did it right at the front of his base. I mean, like, a Baneling Bust could ruin this. Knocks down the pylon and then hits the Cyber Core, and what do you do after that? No Stalkers, Zealot only? No way.
Yeah, or even another one of those big Ling Hydra pushes, getting that range to pick off a bunch of buildings, even outside of the Photon Cannon range. I mean, you could pick off that Forge and 2 pylons easy peasy. I guess it is a little bit of a choke point in front of the Protoss's natural, so maybe a little scary, but I think Blue, the right choice here, in my mind, is just to macro out the whole ton and get to, like, you know, get to 70 workers and say, all right, you know, at 10 minutes, I'm going to be fully saturated on my bases, and it's going to be time to just make attacking units and simply overwhelm them. Maybe a little bit like game 2.
It is, except for in game 2, the thing was that you saw, like, it was literally, like, it was like the Alamo. I mean, we all knew it was coming, but the thing is that, you know, Seldentar, like, just refused to give up. He's like, no, I don't care. I've got a combat unit left, and you're gonna kill all 1,200 of them. Go. You know what I mean? Uh-huh. So, yeah, I mean, and, you're right, and the thing is that this 3 base, like, I don't know, like, it's just completely unmolested. Like, there is no pressure coming out of Seldentar. He needs to do something. Like, all the pressure is coming from Blue, and Blue is breaking down rocks over here on the far right side. You know, he's gonna come through and break down the other set of rocks, and then you're gonna suddenly have a Ling Flood over here by the Robo and your other 2 gateways. I mean, he needs to do something. Either Dark Templar, Warp Prism, something. He needs to put pressure. He needs Blue to be forced to pull his army back. And he's not doing that.
Yeah, I mean, he does have a Warp Prism coming out, and this Dark Shrine might actually get something done.
Where is the Dark Shrine? Am I a Nimnard?
It's in the main.
Why am I not? Oh, there it is. Sorry, I'm used to it being.
It's kind of right in the middle.
Well, yeah. I'm used to it being, like, scrolled off to the side somewhere. So I'm, like, looking by his base, and I see, like, 5 buildings being warped in. I'm like, those are all gateways.
It's just hidden in plain view, man. But I mean, decent spore coverage on Blue's bases. I don't think there's one in the main, but regardless, I mean, I don't, you know, it is pretty hard to get into the main here.
Oh, here it
drops.
Is, but no, look at this Roach push coming on the side. He has no cannons, no defense. I mean, he's warping out Immortal, but it's not enough. This thing's actually going to die. Holy cow. He's going to have to cancel the Immortal. It's not going to finish. He does go down a really nice force field. He cancels the Immortal, but Robo goes down, and he's just kind of like, you know what? F this, I'm out.
Yeah, he had no observers. He sees that Roach burrow and says, well, just can't do it. Yeah, Seldentar had no observers on the map at all. So,
And he was chronoing out an immortal, not an observer, so wow. Mm-hmm. That ended a lot more abruptly than I expected it to. That is for certain. Mm-hmm. So what we're going to do is actually, let me see who is left. Let me get back into the ESL chat if it'll let me. There it is. Seldon Tarlees, we got Zeke Beaver. I love that name. By the way, did you know I had a cast of Zerg whose in-game name was called Captain Buttbeard. And me and this woman named Zephyrus, who's a Zerg player. This is the ZVZ only tournament that I casted.
Oh yeah.
She's like, I want to cast his game just because it's called Captain Buttbeard. And then we got there, and she's like, oh my god, I actually have to say that name like on stream live. I'm like yeah, hey, this times. Is your idea, lady. So Mini Razor looks like he's available. Let's see. Let's take a look at this bracket, peeps, homies, patrons, and fun people. What are we looking at here? So, click the re of the fresh buttons. And where's my stream dashboard? All right. Looks like we do have a semifinal. It is Nixtic versus Mini Razor. We now know that it's going to be Blue versus Apocalypse. And one of those two games will be the ones we're going for. So let me see if Nystic looks like he's still in his match. He's also the only currently ranked Grandmaster left in the tournament. So it'll be very interesting to see this because Nystic versus... Where is he at? Sorry, Nystic versus Mini Razor. Nystic, by the way, is also in a U.S. And I don't think... We haven't had too many Americans actually win the ESL. I don't think we've actually ever had an American win the ESL Open.
Is he the American hope?
He's the American hope, so. And he's killing this, and he's definitely killing Sweden's hope.
Blue is a hope as well, but I'm really scared for him in Apocalypse.
Yeah, agreed.
Mini Razor is also a very good player as well. I mean, who does he play? Is it? I forgot who he plays for now. He was like with Western Wolves for a while and Fnatic, and maybe he doesn't have a team now. I don't know, but he's been a WCS player
qualifier
before. Yeah, all right. I don't know if he was Premier. He was at least certainly Challenger. I don't remember. I don't follow Europe too much though.
So let's see here. I'm gonna see. So, oh, you know what? I didn't notice, but I guess it's not Dubious SC. I guess it's Dubois. He is an Israeli. That is the first time I've seen an Israeli in this tournament. And he actually made it. He's the one fighting. He actually got knocked out by Nystic. So he made it all the way to the quarterfinals before being knocked out. So congratulations to, I think it's Dubios. It's like spelled the French version, so it's got a U in there. SC2, that's awesome. Glad to see. I'm pretty certain that's Israeli. Let me verify that. I'm 90% certain that that's an Israeli player.
Yeah, I think it is. I'm terrible at flags.
Yeah, he is an Israeli player. We do not see too many Israelis here, so awesome. Apparently Israel is struggling with SC2 the way America is, where we've got like a player. So glad to see that you guys also have a player, and that you're rocking it out and, killing the rest of us Americans, because he faced three Americans all the way to get to Nystic. He knocked out Rutger, Arrow, and Zeke. So, So apparently America and Israel really aren't allies. Because otherwise, at the end of the match, I would have just been like, ally, and like we would have both won. Right, so we are waiting. Where is this at? Nystic? I guess that's it. I mean, we're Mini Razor and... Well, hold on, wait a minute.
Are they being... Actually, let me check the Walrus' stream, because I guess he's also doing ESL.
Oh, he is? Oh, okay.
Yeah. At least according to Team Liquid.
He's still in the game? I'm gonna ask Mini Razor because I have varying statuses. Like, Mini Razor doesn't have the SC logo on, so it just shows him as available. So I'm not sure. No, I won. Okay, so Mini Razor actually beat Nystic. So we're looking at Nystic versus. Mini Razor is the first one into the finals. Awesome. Mm-hmm. So actually, the one we're waiting on is actually Apocalypse versus Seldenar. So we're gonna go ahead and cast that game. Let me get these Jamokes in here. Shit. I did it. Can we cast you? Just found out the other semi is over. You are the last match. in the to determine. Oh shit! No, I got the wrong one. Blue won that. Sorry.
Yeah. Oh, were you asking Seldon?
Yeah,
for?
I feel bad.
Salt in the wounds, man.
Sorry.
Proud of you.
I'm an idiot. This is why you don't let a guy who sucks at admin anything ever. Where's blue? Hold on.
Do you have your stream on Team Liquid, by the way, or no?
I do. I do have it on Team Liquid. Oh,
all
right, so
associate it with the ESL America Open.
I did. I thought I did. I thought I sent it to. Hold on. Where the hell is it?
I mean, you can do it as we get in the game.
No.
Or whatever.
Where is it at? There. Save changes. Is it not? Now it should be broadcasting. I thought I had that saved earlier. Did I forget to do that? Oh, I went potato.
Okay, as long as, I mean, the important part is getting into this match, but, oh, I should join the game. There
yes,
it is.
Do not miss that once again.
I don't want to show disrespect to Apocalypse.
No, he might come wreck your face.
He's already done that before.
All right, by the way, guys, this is the last semifinal. This is a best of three still. We will be heading into the final. Whoever wins this match will go ahead and actually face, not Mystic, the other, whatever. There's someone in the finals. I'll find out here in a second. I can't remember. I just talked to him.
Mini-Razor.
Thank you, Mini-Razor. So whoever wins this is going to face Mini-Razor in the finals. This is going to be for the third place match, basically. So anyway, starting on the right-hand side of the map, around the 5 o'clock position, it's our Blue Terran. This is Apocalypse.
And we'll call him the contender. He is our pink Zerg. It is blue.
All right, so both these players, you and I have both casted in this exact tournament before. So what do you think blue should do to knock out Apocalypse? Because you said you were worried. So what can he do against this cheeky, you know, two-raxing Reaper master Apocalypse?
Scout a lot and try and be real safe. I don't know, man. It looks like we're probably going to see that same proxy racks.
I really gotta start doing this. I'm literally going to steal this build and yeah. Pray to God that I can pull it off on my own with my 1 APM American skills.
Yeah, it takes a lot of a decent chunk of micro. But yeah, if you can see that bunker actually going down, because I think last game Apocalypse started it before the Reaper was really like in position, because sometimes mm-hmm. it's hard to actually stop the bunker because the Reaper, you know, is defending it.
Yeah, and there's a really good place actually to put it, and it's literally, so if you look at the ramp leading to the natural, and you mm-hmm. go directly south of whatever that like circular bowl looking object is, that yeah. is just out of the vision of creep. So if you can sneak yep. a worker in there and just slap it down, you're good.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's a very, very good spot to bunker, kind of do a little bunker rush. And yeah, I mean, blue having, okay, he gets the spawning pool down. He's not going super greedy with like a gas and then spawning pool. That could be, you know, the worst kind of situation for this. But yeah, he might have seen that the SCV. Catches the SCV. Nicely done.
Yeah, perfectly timed. It's like there's map hacks. I'm kidding. There's none.
Or maybe it's like he watched I don't know.
The previous stream. But we'll see, because there's no overlord like going that direction. Like, we got the one overlord in the base. We got the one overlord sitting over here just guarding the ramp between the National and the Third. The Reaper's coming in. The bunker is going on. What? He didn't stop it. I must have missed that.
Yeah, he just kind of brought the drone back home. He was like, oh, no, we're good. But it's going to be in for a pretty terrible surprise. I mean, this is not... it's not the end of the world. Nicely done with the spine crawler. He sees that bunker and says, "All right, whatever. I'll make some spines." You can't really kill spine crawlers with a Reaper.
No, so even if you repair it, you're done. I mean, he can get a few kills in, but I mean,
yeah, maybe losing too many drones. But you know, at the end of the day,
that's close. The the second Reaper, what's he gonna do? Oh, he hops them both in. And you know what? He's gonna have to focus us down. This isn't gonna do enough damage, unfortunately. I mean, it's barely doing more damage than it's earning through its regeneration. And he's gonna have to salvage this bunker quick, because both of these spine crawlers are in range of the bunker.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, letting both of those spine crawlers finish, or making them both finish. I mean, Apocalypse, it's kind of like taking what you can get, you know? That's it's 200 minerals and two more drones that got removed from the economy, and so still doing plenty of damage, even though it looks like it got held back, but, you know, it's... Blue's still not out of the fight right now. He's, it's like when you're... It's like your house is on fire, and you just blew it up to stop the fire from spreading or something? I don't know.
No, but the example would be like, because, you know, you throw water on the floor so that it doesn't, like, jump or something, but, I don't know, you're right. The thing is, instead of these Reapers, you're kind of like, whatever, you ain't got no more links, brah. I'm just gonna shoot something that I can shoot. Oh, and all of a sudden these links come out here and decide to re-engage the fight. The Spinecrawl is holding on. The hatchery, however, is not, like, doing that great. It's down 25% of its health. There's now a fourth Reaper joining the fight. There are no drones at the natural. So basically the natural is just kind of like, hey, look, I've got three workers. Yay me, I've got workers. And nothing can really engage four Reapers. I mean, you're going to one-shot anything with the exception of the Queen. So now he engages with the Queen. This is nice. This is what he had to wait for. He had to basically take this on the nose while he waited. The Queen now, unfortunately, is getting focused down. The Spinecrawler is moving. He's trying to push with these. He doesn't have many lanes left, and this is just looking very desperate, actually, for Blue. The Queen is gone. That is going to hurt a lot.
Yeah, I mean, this is a point in time when... and behind this the whole time, Apocalypse has just been making all sorts of command centers, so he's going to have a great economy behind this. And, you know, as long as he retains all these Reapers, and he's doing great to micro them out, I don't think he's lost...
lost a single unit, period. End of story. Yeah. No units whatsoever.
And yeah, I mean, behind this, yeah, Apocalypse is able to keep Blue under control, continue to macro up as a Terran, and then just have some sort of killer push coming, you know, really as soon as he...
He lost his first unit.
Game over.
Yeah, that's it. Sorry. Sorry, you're... Wow. And you know what? Not only did he not lose a unit in that first push, but he managed to float the racks back to his own base from mid-map, which is just crazy.
Yeah, so Apocalypse in a great place. He's going to be pumping out SCVs immensely right now. I guess speed has started for Blue, but I mean, there's no like Baneling. You know, maybe if you had a Baneling nest, you could just like speed Baneling all in and try and do something crazy. He is going to run. I mean, I assume these Banelings are going to be running over to the natural base of Apocalypse, but Apocalypse already evacuating his SCVs preemptively, and he's got a couple of Hellions to make sure that they'll be able to kite those those speedlings, as well as just sit behind. They really feel like it sit behind the supply depot and roasty toasty.
Yeah, that's not going to be real well. I hate to say it, but the not hard counter to Zerglings is Hellions and other things that do splash damage of some sort, which Hellions do damage in a single line. So like anything within the path of their flame kind of turns into alien bacon at that point.
Yeah, so not a great spot for Blue right now. It's going to be real tough to... I'm going to be honest. I feel like he doesn't really even have a way out of this right now. I feel like Apocalypse would have to make a major mistake to actually throw this game away. I don't... Mm-hmm. You know, it's... it's getting close to a numbers game kind of thing where it's just... There's just not enough Zerg to really do anything about this Terran. Unless Apocalypse just, like... didn't attack for a while, but we've seen Apocalypse be one of the most aggressive Terrans probably in this whole tournament. And so there's certainly no way that he's going to miss a chance to attack. And we see that armory. As soon as that armory finishes, I have a very strong feeling we'll be seeing a whole bunch of Hellbats, a couple of Banshees, and
I don't think you need to see a whole lot of Hellbats, because you don't need the armory for Banshees, but there is... eight Hellions moving out, and this is going to spell doom if he doesn't have some way to deal with it.
Yeah, I mean, and the Hellbats can tank, it's
And he's just kind of like, you know what, F that, I'm done.
Yeah, I think that's Apocalypse's foreigner killer. I think I've seen him use that build before. Pretty much, it's just Reaper Harass into Hellion Banshee and game over, man.
You know what the only thing about wearing the sombrero is? I can't itch the back of my head. Really, yeah. Really causing some serious. By the way, if you guys are wondering what the hell's going on right now, Nivik and I, he's wearing a Christmas suit outfit. He's dressed as a Christmas tree that blinks. You can barely see the blinking, but here, I'll enlarge it so you guys can see the blinkage. There. That's him blinking.
Kinda works.
He had a Robin Hood hat on earlier, and I'm wearing a sombrero because I'm going to Mexico. And so I'm like, well, why not sombrero?
So it's costume stream.
It is. And you know what the funny thing is? This wasn't originally a cosplay stream. This started... So... Nivik and I actually hunt. Did I get kicked out of... Damn it, I get kicked out of this game every time. At least I'm not disconnecting. Like, before I had to log in, and I almost pulled a day 9 where I typed my password on stream. Alright.
Okay, well, they're waiting for you at least.
Alright, I'm back. I'm back. They can re-invite me. I'm there. So, alright, there we go. Yeah, I don't know. I've got, like I said, it only happens when I stream, and it seems that it especially happens when I have, you know, someone on Skype video chat, Crococaster. So anyway, it happens with me and Pluto too. It's not just you.
I can feel the shade from over here.
But you know what? Look at this. Full on sombrero mode. Like I'm wearing like a boss.
Gosh.
You can't see this face. Like, you don't know what's underneath it. You just see a sombrero. I'm going to wear it the way, like, thugs do it, where I can't even see my top monitor because it's so high. Anyway. So, in the lower right-hand corner, taking game one using his tricky Reaper push. It's the Korean player. It's Apocalypse.
And up on the top left-hand side of the map, he wasn't quite able to stop the Reaper attack out of Apocalypse and fell down to quite a load of Hellbats. It is our pink Zerg, our American player. It's Blue.
Yeah, my boy, Blue!
My boy! So hopefully he can... I mean, I think if he's just like... Jeez, I don't know. It's just such a hard... attack to really figure out how to stop, because it just requires a lot of really precise control and just kind of, you almost need to anticipate it a lot. And I mean, I think if he had kept that drone on the SCB, maybe he'd have a little better chance. Mm-hmm. But again, we're seeing the same old, you know, same old proxy barracks.
All right, Blue, you gotta scout this. But this is a weird position. Now, there's two things about this. First of all, it's behind the foliage, which obstructs view. So even if he's kind of scouts, like, and if you follow my camera, if he scouts at his natural and goes up here, he's not going to see it. If he takes a long way, he'll see it, but no one does that. It's out of the path of the Overlord, of both Overlords, so you're not going to do it. Because normally you'd proxy down here at the third. That way you've got a short path in the natural and go up. But by proxying here, and by taking advantage of the terrain, he can hop up the edge here, and it's a straight shot from that barracks right up to the one ledge that he can get on the eastern side of Blue's base. So this is actually very well thought out. He's gonna bring the worker back in there. And you know what, I really think the Blue's gonna be kinda like really same build again. And the spawning pool is just now going down, which is not gonna finish for another 55 seconds. And that is simply not enough time. He's not gonna have any defense for this. And I honestly think that this is heavily favoring Apocalypse at this moment.
Yeah, I mean, oh my gosh, Blue, keep that drone on the SCV. No! Oh, he sees the bunker. Okay, that's good. All right. Though.
By the way, I'd like to say, Dubious SC2, thank you for the follow. That's awesome. The Reaper does come in here. He's going to get a few kills. If he can somehow just focus on that SCV and prevent it from finishing, this will actually mean a world of good. But he's not, because he's terrified he's going to lose his workers. The spawning pool does finally pop. Zerglings will come out, but he really needs to kill that bunker. That bunker needs to die.
Yeah, it almost feels like it. Maybe if he just committed a few more drones and was just like, whatever, we're getting that SCV 100%, you know? But as it is, he kind of flip-flop between all of it, and then we lose. Oh, man. Yeah, we're We're gonna have some nightmares of this. I honestly don't know. I mean, I think you have to stop that bunker from coming down.
That's one of those things where, as a Terran player, like, now he's pulling the worker rush to sort of corner it. Too little, too late. He should have done it on the SCV, sacrificed it, kept the one Reaper there, and then been able to stop the bunker from finishing. I mean, he hasn't really utilized the bunker, but the fact that it's there is the problem.
Yeah, I mean, he can just go back there, be safe, heal up, and all of that, and be be totally fine. Oh, just barely keeps that one Reaper alive at very, very low health.
Oh, this engagement is just not going well. He doesn't have anything that can really go into the range of the bunker, so he finally gets the bunker. What he really needs to do is put the Spine Crawler kind of like close. He needs to make two Spine Crawlers. One close to the base, one close to, there it is. Finally, there it is. It's pokey, stabby, stabby. Three Reapers are not going to take down that thing. He salvages it. He realizes this is not the way to go. I mean, the natural has got some drones, but unfortunately, the Reapers are just going to go down there and murder life.
Yeah, it's just not a good place for Blue to be in right now. And this is probably a style he hasn't seen that much, especially with the type of control that Apocalypse is able to bring to this. I mean, he's been pulling back individual hurt Reapers, you know, keeping them at 5 health, making sure they're able to regen back up. Yeah, we've got a Reaper. Yeah, we've got two Reapers at less than 10 health right now, I think. And
I know, and he just cannot kill them off, and he's losing drones as of his job. Yeah. And you know what? He realizes that, and that is it. And by the way, to Descended One, what happened with Day 9 is a couple of years ago, his Battle.net disconnected, and so what happened was is that it's one of these things where it's hit or miss whether or not it prompts you. Okay, so what it's supposed to do is it's supposed to save your username no matter what, even if you choose don't remember me, because that only applies when you shut the game down and start over again. What happened was that Day 9 assumed that it was going to prompt him with just the password, so he started typing, but he was typing in the username field and typed out his entire password, which happened to be the password for every account on everything he ever owned. So he canceled the stream for a half an hour and changed his password on everything, and that is what happened. So, yeah, so anyway, yeah, looks like Blue gets shut down by some very cheeky play that I'm going to steal and use, and I'm going to get to Masters using that. So there's that.
But we're going to be able to see, I think we're the only people casting, so I suppose we'll have the the pleasure of getting to see Miniraiser against Apocalypse.
We do, and now that Apocalypse is won, we have to get the admins in, so I've got to talk to Sinestro and get him to create the lobby. So,
sure.
So we gotta do that.
I'll be here blinking away.
All right.
I think I can. I think I get to pay the last Midwest Cup person. Yay! And I'm all done with paying people.
All right. Make the game hard though. All right, so Sinestro, who's the admin, is going to go ahead and do this. It's going to be you and me casting, and it's going to be Apocalypse and Miniraiser wrecking each other's faces. And from there, it's going to be dope as hell. By the way, ignore AGCL, also known as Silver Chloride. He happens to just be, I think he's another one of the admins. But he... so anyway, he's a cool guy. He actually tried to help me fix my Battle.net issues. So thank you, Silver Chloride. By the way, for those who don't know, this is the ESL America's number 25 Open. $50 is on the line. Just invite Nivek. Jesus, I said that earlier, Derp Dorp. God, so difficult. All right, winner takes all. Sometimes they'll split up, they'll be like 35-15, but at this point, nope. Gonna be 50-0. That's all you get. So, you know what? This definitely deserves a toast. This is the finals. Below me is Nivek706. Go ahead and give him a follow. He has been a real bro. I would have had to actually cast this entire thing by myself if he had not shown up. So please, actually, and I'm actually going to ask you guys to leave my stream for a few seconds. Go to his channel and follow him because he didn't have to do this. All right? I want to make that abundantly clear. He didn't have to do this.
I had to. No. I was compelled to.
He was compelled to, but I told him that the gun next to his head I would get rid of if he casted. So, but nice. Please give him a follow. He is a StarCraft II Zerg player. He hosts. He is the originator, the benefactor of the Midwest Cup, which is a Midwest only tournament, but it has a minimum prize pool of $200, which is dope if you think about it. And then he also streams kind of randomly from time to time. He does like RPGs. He does StarCraft stuff. Sometimes he'll also do his coding stuff. So, you did it for the overlays that you did. You did a stream where you did the overlays.
Yeah, that's pretty fun.
USA is subsidizing esports. Ha! Yeah, that'll be a first.
Well, I think honestly, like the U.S. or like North America, it's kind of funny because like I feel like a decent amount of money comes from North America, but like not very talented players. Not the top players. Maybe I won't say not talented, they're just not the top players. It might come down to practice and training and all of that, but yeah.
Well, I mean, like even EG tried the training house out in like Tempe, Arizona a few years back. So they tried to do it. The problem is it's not the... Okay, so here's the thing. Like, the way the Asian culture is that if you're going to get into something, then you get into it as either a pre-adolescent or an adolescent or a young adult, you know, sort of thing. And you give it your all in. And the families and the culture there for things like the training houses, like that's sort of expected. I hate to say this almost goes all the way back to like the old like geisha sort of commercial like thing where you had training houses for geishas, you know, And that's sort of the way it went. It's like this is considered accepted. In the United States, we're too spread out. The country is too, like, this is my family. We're together. We don't like people invading our family. You know, it's a little different when you're crammed onto a series of small islands that's less than the size of California. You know, and Korea is very similar. It's a peninsula, so it's just different cultures, different way things happened, and so the training house in the U.S. just didn't work, and you end up with decent American players, but they just don't have like the sort of like OCD about things that the Korean culture relating to StarCraft has.
There's just certainly not the intensity, I think, at which people will practice and train and especially like you say you're gonna do something and you're just like I'm gonna be the best at this and you go and do it. It takes a whole lot of drive to really get there.
Mm-hmm. By the way, please note that we are both referees. Do not ping on the map unnecessarily. I know you don't do that, just thought I'd mention that.
I don't think it shows the players, but
as a referee it does. Everything shows, like if you hit all, it'll do it, but like the other pings and things, like a lot of it shows, so just don't risk it.
Oh, I don't think pings do, but
really? Well, I'm not going to do it regardless. Anyway, because if I do, I always tend to ping all over the map and like I spam the map with pings.
Yeah, no. I mean regardless, I don't even know what the hotkey is for that.
it's Alt G.
Yeah, no. I mean I was kind of kidding, but
uh-huh. What do you like usually spam that? I mean, what the hell's going on?
No, I don't ping in StarCraft.
Since I made I gotta type in the chat real quick here.
No problem. Yeah, I think we're waiting on Mini Razor. Okay, he's back. I think he took a quick little break, but we are hopping into game in just a little bit.
Now, the finals are a best of five. Looks like the first map is going to be on Coda. So that means that there was only three maps there was only two maps vetoed, because it literally just goes A, B, and then into the five series. So, so this hopefully will be a good series. It's a TVZ, which we've seen a lot of those tonight, like a surprising amount. Like I've seen so few Terrans in the last several tournaments that I've casted. So it's very nice to see a return to the Terran dominance, as it should be, by the way. Zerg, OP, die. Oh, shoot, overlay. Kevin?
Struggle's real.
Oh, yo. Okay. By the way, I hear a pulsating hum, so if you have power breaks near things, please move. move it, as I said before. By the way, Alan Knight.
That's somebody mowing their lawn.
Oh, okay. Great. Alan Knight, thank you for the follow. Awesome, dope. All right, but we're going to get into this real quick here. Currently dominating with his very crazy, like, one racks proxy Reaper into bunker in your Zerg base face ace is Apocalypse, and I'm delaying because I'm reading stuff in the chat too.
Oh, they're telling us not to ping. That's okay. I wasn't going to anyway. I'm still not convinced that pings show, but I'll have to test it. Not okay. here. Not going to test it here.
Whatever you say.
I'm not. I won't even touch my keyboard.
You don't even. Do you not know how to touch your keyboard? Are you going to introduce a Zerg player, or do I have to do that?
I wasn't. All right. Let's see how it is. I thought we had a good thing going. I guess no. All right. So, on the bottom right hand side of the map, we haven't seen him play in this tournament yet, but he is a very good Swedish Zerg player. We have Mini Razor in the blue.
Right. So I got a question. So obviously you're rooting for Mini Razor, and I'm rooting for, ironically, the Korean. I can't believe those words came out of my mouth. Mainly because it's a North American tournament, I would like to see a non-Korean win, but because we have had a few do it, and it's just nice to see a change of the guard every now and then. And seeing a Swede win something would be awesome, just because there are so few Swede StarCraft players. There's a couple of pro players that are from Sweden, but it would be really awesome to see this, even though I have to say, freaking Zerg. Anyway, so what would you like to see out of Mini Razor? What can he do to stop the perpetual, like, silliness of Apocalypse?
Well, I think they were actually discussing it in chat as well. A couple people were probably people that are better at this game than I am. I guess it's possible to do without actually stopping the bunker. I'm not even really sure. Like, I feel like it's got to be impeccable micro for Mini Razor to really do that, although it looks like we're not going to see the same thing. I think, Apocalypse probably knows who Mini Razor is. I mean, Mini Razor's been a pro or semi-pro player for a decent amount of time. So maybe showing a little bit of respect to his opponent, thinking, all right, I know that Mini Razor probably be able to hold this off if it actually happens. Did he ever? Well, I mean, he's seen the Zerglings now. Okay, he did scout.
See the Zerglings, so he knows that there's some early pressure coming. I mean, it is six Zerglings versus the typical two or four that you see. So he obviously did not plan on fully droning the way he wanted to. But there is a wall up. I mean, like, he's got the depot, so that's okay. The natural. Oh, he'll be able to lift. It finishes just in time, but he decides to go, you know, at full potato. Not full potato. Sorry, full orbital. I don't know why I would say potato. That was a very not potato appropriate comment. but he has no way of defending it, so either this orbital finishes and he lifts, or it dies a horrible death, and we see the very first Zerg rush that kills this guy. So anyway, he does throw the factory down. That ain't gonna finish in time. Does he lift? Does he lift? Lift it? Oh, he does lift it. Alright, good.
Not even
burned. The depot!
No! Oh! Well, it was good micro, though. Yeah.
Wow,
the Apocalypse
the
is a chain.
Wow, that was very good.
Yeah.
So once you're trapped in a Terran base, Nivik, what do you do as a Zerg player?
I think part of it is just trying to keep your units alive for as long as possible, and you also want to scout what all the buildings are. I mean, you don't want to get... You have this opportunity to be in the base. You better not get thrown off by some sort of, like, hidden, you know, I don't know, hidden Banshee tech or something like that. I don't know. He was able to see all the gases, so he knows that there's, you know, he sees only one gas, so he knows there's not going to be real quick cloaked Banshees or something like that. He's able to see the factory and the barracks, and you know he knows that. All right, it's probably going to be. I think he saw the reactor starting. Yeah,
he
so
did,
he's
he
like,
did.
All right, Hellions. You know, it's pretty normal.
Yeah, and if the Hellions, like I said, in order to kill workers though, you need three Hellions without upgrades. That is, so no plus ones and no blue flames to kill workers. So the thing is that two does a good job, but you have to micro them impeccably versus the inevitable, queen and zergling pressure, and occasionally a spine crawler. There are no spine crawlers yet, but these two hellions are going to move out. They probably will get a few kills. I doubt that they're going to leave empty-handed, because even me is like the absolutely garbage platinum/gold player that I am, depending on what season we're looking at, can get a few kills, even with the best of defenses from Zerg.
We'll see. I mean, it's nuts. Like, even just watching, the pro players able to fend off. I don't know if it's just like a respect thing or something, but like, I'll see something like four Hellions against like two or three Queens, and they just don't rush up the ramp, and they don't kind of YOLO it. And really, at the end of the day, part of it is you pretty much are guaranteeing that you're sacrificing your Hellion if you're doing that. So we'll see if Apocalypse goes for it, if he backs off. Oh, he's going for it.
Oh, no, nope. Screw that. You're going all the way. He goes in with it, and the thing is, you just run these things around. The Queen can't keep up. If there's a few... Oh, excellent. Oh, wow, that was really well done. He managed to actually get all four Hellions, and he pinned them in with just three drones. That was very, very good, because normally the Hellions will just kind of sneak by and whatever, but he did a great job. And there's the Banshee. The Banshee now sees the Zerglings, and the Zerglings now see the Banshee. So it's like, all right, he's going Zergling. Yeah. I guarantee you, what is that? Where is it at? Hold on. Do we see the... No, there's no Spore Crawler yet, but there should be.
But this is the classic Roach Baneling pseudo, sort of all in, certainly big time pressure. Where if this Banshee doesn't go to, it kind of has to stay home to try and defend, because really Apocalypse has like three units to try and defend this with. I mean, he's got one Marine now and one Banshee, and that's all that Apocalypse has. So Mini Razor might actually pull this out. He's got two. Apocalypse now got his second Banshee out, so it's certainly going to clean this up. We'll see what kind of economic damage is actually able to be done. Currently, both players on the same worker counts, just about. So as it is, if all these roaches get cleaned up without any more worker kills, then Apocalypse probably is still in a comfortable place, but we keep getting worker kills out of this, and now we're finally down to, even more Zerglings, more Banelings coming in to clean up even more SCVs. If they stay in this clump, it's going to be a bad day. Oh, that looks like Baneling food right there.
That is terrible. Now, there are four Banelings morphing right outside the factory.
Yeah, if they get there.
The mule is not mining, which he needs critically to be able to go ahead and keep it. So somehow Apocalypse manages to hold this off. He needs to go ahead and use these Banshees and kill this. He's going to actually be supply blocked when that depot dies, so he's going to be in trouble. When that one dies, yes, now he's even on supply. He needs to build another depot. He's decided he's going to go ahead and move his factory to build another reactor. I'm not sure what... I think he's going to wait for that Marine to finish and then go from there. But wow, that was very touch and go that entire time. And by the way, Zero Length, yes, you said Naniwa is a Swede, but we don't talk about Naniwa because supposedly he's dating some really... Well, that's a conversation for another stream. If you guys are familiar with a streamer, a gold or platinum level streamer known as Tiger Lily, supposedly they're dating? Anyway, whatever, we don't care about dating who's dating, we just care who's wrecking who. And who's wrecking who currently is undecided, because there's Marines, there's STEM, there's mines,
and the mines
do all the damage on the Marines. Oh my god.
That team kill right there.
You know
that
what?
Was massive.
That is when your teammate in a team game points all his tanks at the one Zergling heading into your units.
Yeah, and now it's really just on these cloaked Banshees to try and get something done. There's no spores at the third base of Mini Razor. Maybe a bit of a mistake.
And you know what?
Actually, no spore. There's not a lot of spore coverage.
How many kills did they get so far? There are two drones, three drones coming. There is nothing here. There's an Overseer coming, but three Banshees versus two Banshees, because the other one's about dead, versus three Queens will not work. I mean, you can kill... Yeah. You can kill a lot with a Banshee. Like, a Banshee versus a Queen, the Banshee will win. But there's no way you're going to beat three Queens, three Banshees with an Overseer and a weakened Banshee. And he sends that one home, actually, because it's necessary. The Spore is still there, and Mews are coming out. There's a few more drone kills, but there just really isn't much that these Banshees are going to be able to do with the Overseer and the Spore Crawler and two Queens.
Yeah. Yeah, so I think, Mini Razor's in a... Not a bad place at this point in time, surprisingly enough.
Here comes the drop. Here comes what's necessary. You've got, pardon me, you've got to use what you have available to you, and that is drops. He's got to keep the Zerg army from attacking. He is moving his third over to the base, but there is a the flying bulb things, can't think of the name, puking creep. Overlords, oh my god.
We've also got mutas into the main and the natural of Apocalypse, and barely any, I mean, no real missile turrets finished up yet. He's just trying to finish a few. A handful of Marines are going to be able to keep this out of the natural, but the main is pretty much, oh, please, kill. Oh, kill combat shields. So close.
No, the mutas leave because they realize the city in the main
he's gotta go home.
Is a bunch of Marines that are stimmed up and just wrecking everything. Now with the Swarcaller gone and the main not mining, there's actually an opportunity for him to take advantage of that. Is one of the medevacs full of Marines. Oh, that was hard. And he's running right into the mutas, and the mutas are going to pick off this one. Oh my god, he loses the entire drop!
Oh man, that's real bad. we're coming close to a point where it's going to be really hard for Apocalypse to actually come back out of this one. I mean, he does have some amazing micro ability, but you know, sometimes the Zerg Swarm just, I don't know how, I guess the full frontal attack. You know what? It'll work out in this case. It's just enough to clean up all the Marines.
Yeah, and the Bailey's gonna come in. The Mines are gonna go ahead and get a couple shots. They get almost all the Banes. He needs one Marine that'll shoot, and he actually manages to keep most of his Marines together. The Mutas, however, aren't just wrecking face, they're wrecking base. So, you know what? There aren't enough Marines here. There's a few workers out there to help, but unfortunately, drilling is not working. Apocalypse loses the first game that you and I have casted. That is amazing.
Dang. All right. Also, my room is so dark now.
I was trying to get the
Christmas
the
lights going.
Hold on. Oh, you know what the thing is? You need to like turn up like the contrast so we can like only see the Christmas lights. actually, I'm gonna do the same thing. So give me a second. Looks like I did get put
I'll
back in the party.
Lights on.
Yay! We're gonna play some music here. We're gonna go back to what is it? So in the game, all right, we're gonna do this. We're gonna put what is it? Where is there?
I'm like the most beautiful Christmas tree that
you are
that my mother's
a beautiful
ever
man
seen.
That helps too.
Anyway.
Hey, you know what? I say it like I see it, man.
We'll take the probably turn the lights off now that.
Yeah, and I have to turn another light on and turn the air conditioning down because it finally cooled off here, and I'm like freezing in my apartment. Like, it's seriously about 4,000 degrees below zero. Like, I'm pretty certain that, like, the salt we saw in the Midwest Cup was warmer than this, okay? Anyway, so on the intermission, you're listening to Fractal Dreaming. I'm replaying the song just because it's very much like background music. I'm DJ Spectre, sitting below me in here. This is Nivik706. You should go ahead and check him out, follow his stream. He's been a very generous man with his time. He has donated the rest of his afternoon and evening when he should have been doing domesticated stuff like looking for a house to casting StarCraft and wearing a Christmas tree costume. So
I don't
give him props
happens.
Alone for the Christmas tree costume.
I've made poor choices in life, I think, right now.
It's okay. I'm wearing a sombrero that hurts my head over wireless headphones, and I'm drinking Tecate in a Cubs koozie. So those are all poor choices.
I think this is like when like your teacher asks you what you want to be when you grow up. I think this is probably it, right?
A lazy ass who broadcasts like nerd games over the internet. Okay, that whole phrase wasn't around when I was a kid.
That's true.
Like when my teachers were asking me in junior high, like StarCraft hadn't been invented yet, like the first game, and then they're like, let's see here, okay.
Yeah, we look good.
All right, we're gonna go ahead and flip over to number one. We're gonna flip into this main screen here. Control M for the game. But yeah, like it hadn't been invented, and like streaming wasn't around. I'm like, all right. So what is streaming? Like, do I just take a bunch of streamers and put them on a pole and act like a gymnast or what? So, anyhow, we're gonna let this song at least finish here for the beginning part because there's nothing really going on in this game. Currently down, surprisingly, 1-0 in this best of five, the finals of the ESL Open number 25. It is Apocalypse as our Red Terran.
And he took the game in a... It was a little touch and go, but a very nicely executed Roach Baneling bust, followed up by a lot of good Zerg pressure. He's our blue Zerg from Sweden. He needs to win the next two to win this whole tournament. It is Mini Razor. It's best of five, right?
It is a best of five, yes.
Okay.
The ESL does allow the players to decide if they want to split the pool between first and second place, whether it's 35-15 for the $50 pool or not. In this case, it is not. It is all or nothing. So either Apocalypse wins three games right now and just shuts out his opponent, or Mini Razor wins two more. Either way, someone's going home with $50 or the foreign equivalent of that. Is Sweden in the Eurozone? Are they part of the Euro?
They use the kroner or whatever. I only know that.
Okay, so
yeah, I only know
then.
That because
okay.
DreamHack every time is like 10 million DreamHack or Swedish kroner. Or so, I don't know what it is.
And it ends
but,
up being like $65 or something, right?
No, I don't think it's that. I don't think it's that crazy, but.
Alright, we'll fade this down.
I don't want to look it up. So one. Or one. Wait. Is there a Danish krona? What is.
No, it's Swedish krona. You're right in that. I'm 90% certain.
Yeah, but there's a Danish kroner and there's a Swedish krona.
What is this? Hold on. Is that four drones moving cross map with this?
Hello.
Release? What in the fail?
Enough
oh my
about
God.
Currencies.
Yeah, Zerglings are not currency, but drones are not combat units.
I'm like real concerned here about this actually doing anything, because as soon as a. I mean, this is like countered, right?
Oh, this was like the sort of worker all in. So he goes up. There's a Reaper coming out, but now they're bringing over more SCVs to go ahead and deal with this. He's gonna be able to actually take down this. Wait a minute. Yeah, he's actually draining health on this building.
How does this? What are the point of the workers? I'm so confused.
No, what it is so a combat priority. So you bring the workers
up. I guess.
Yeah. So that's all it is. But you don't take down the eBay. You take down the bunker or the depot. Wow.
Well, but you can't repair the eBay because it's currently being built.
Yeah,
so maybe that's.
What?
I think Mini Razor doesn't like this map. Maybe that's it.
No, Apocalypse just. Oh wow! Why did he do that?
Apocalypse
won. That is strange. Like, no, you can. By the way, you can repair something that's being.
While it's being built?
Yeah, you can.
So.
No, you can. You can repair it while it's being built. Yes, you can. As a Terran, you can repair it while it's being built.
I don't trust you.
I'm telling you, you can do it. I've done it.
All right.
Because it still technically took damage.
Yeah, but like you can't transfuse a building when it's building.
Yeah, but
like,
you're not Terran. We're OP. We've been over this.
Excuse me, I needed to.
You need to check yourself before you wreck yourself.
I thought you couldn't repair.
No, you can. You can repair it. Because you, I know you can also repair the worker that's doing it too, right?
Well, yeah, I've seen that one before. I've seen some tricky little plays with that, but yeah, I think Mini Razor just didn't want to play in this map or something, or he wants to go to bed. I'm really confused. He just suddenly lost his will to live or something.
Yeah, so he extended the series further.
I guess.
Like,
I don't know.
The logic here is falling on craziness.
I'm thinking he just didn't like the map, I guess. It is a weird map, and I can see players just maybe being like, whatever, throwing it away. I don't know. It's a little bit dramatic, but, you know, it happens.
Yeah, it does. It does. What is this? Hold on. Wanted to watch replay go next. Mini dropped?
Did Mini want to watch the replay, I guess? Whatever. Looks like we're in it.
All right, we're doing this game three of this best of five. Homies, homettes, pimps, players, and hoes, whatever's out there watching, you know. By the way, I want to let you guys know I've got 99 followers. 99. The 100th, I've got to come up with something to make the 100th follower feel special. But if you do it, like, I'll figure it out.
I mean, I'm already wearing a Christmas tree, and you're wearing a sombrero hat.
Yeah, but this one, I don't have any subscribers, so it's like, what's going on here? Oh, there's music. So anyway, all right. Using an eBay, apparently, to save his life in the last match through some, like, ridiculously fast game, the Red Terran in the upper left, it is our guy, Apocalypse.
And Not sure what he was up to last game, but we'll see if he can make a difference in this game. Perhaps go with a more conventional strategy. Our blue Zerg mini razor.
Does that make everyone dizzy from staring at that Zerg?
So yeah, I mean, well, at least at this point, we haven't had an early pool yet.
Yeah, I know. Okay.
You know, nothing too weird yet. And yeah, I mean, I don't know. I can see Miniraiser just maybe not liking that map. I don't know. Anyway, but I was almost surprised that Apocalypse didn't like do a maybe Miniraiser did that to be like, you know what, Apocalypse, I'm crazy. All right, don't proxy Rax me. I will wreck you. You
well,
know.
Apparently he did something because that was some baller stuff we just saw, man.
Because
players and hoes, whatever's
because I could almost see this being a pretty good map for I mean, Apocalypse has done it. I mean, he did it earlier, right?
Mm-hmm.
against blue, a very successful proxy rax into bunker. Not gonna happen this time, but Miniraiser certainly going for a much safer, a bit of a safer opening. You usually don't go spawning pool first up against Terrans. It's pretty much always a 15 hatch and then a 15 pool. But this way, Miniraiser he'll get a queen out earlier. He has the option to get Zerglings out earlier, so it's certainly going to be able to protect against some bunker shenanigans a little bit more easily.
Bunker-nanigans shabunkerage.
Indeed. I'm a little curious here to see if maybe Miniraiser goes for... Sometimes players will go for like a wraparound with these Zerglings. They won't use them to defend. They'll just kind of go around, try and avoid the Reaper, and try and kill off a low ground command center, or deal some pressure to the supply depots and the barracks at the front. So we'll see if they're able to make it happen. It looks like right now Miniraiser's getting a little sneaky. Is it getting intercepted? Oh,
he does! But you know, if you surround on the Reaper, this is gonna be tough. I mean, without speed, they really can't catch the Reaper. The Reaper can literally kite for days, but that many Zerglings are actually holding this off due to the delay on the, you know, when he goes to Microid. But this is the only unit he has right now out on the field. I mean, he doesn't have any other combat units to deal with this. Not that the Zerglings are gonna be able to do anything. The second Reaper finally pops, but the Zerglings might be able to get out this worker, but he decides to just be like, yo, let's see what's up here. We sack this, we do a little bit of damage, and unfortunately that was very, well, useless.
Well, it kept the Reapers back. I mean, they weren't pressuring Miniraiser's base at that point in time, so I guess that's pretty good, but...
But there's no bunker, there's no worker. I mean, they're literally just two Reapers, you know, holding hands. Oh. Jumping into the main here, and you know, the queen's not there. Where's the queen? Oh,
yeah,
the queen is on top. Oh, there, the queen's there. So, you know, yeah. You can't kill a queen with two reapers unless you get like.
Certainly can. I mean,
it's difficult, and I'm not saying it's easy.
It takes a little bit of time to come back and regen, but yeah, it's a real you know.
It's a real thing.
Yeah, it's a real thing to worry about.
So he does recall the queen back to the natural to do the inject, and he decides to bring it back up here, but it's going to be a long time before that queen comes back, and actually he decides, you know, screw it, I'm going to send these workers over to the other base where they can be abused. The queen's going to go ahead and try to work away on these three reapers, but it's just not enough. He needs the other queen finally, he decides to be queen, like, he finally stops being, like, herp-a-derp and brings them both. The Zerglings are gonna get taken out, but not before he forces, you know, at least the Reapers to evacuate. He almost gets a surround on them. Ooh, that was close.
Yeah, I mean, and behind this, we're seeing Apocalypse's standard time to build 3 CCs in the background, get a bunch of orbitals.
Oh my god,
I guess
we're
on the wrong scene the whole time.
Hold on.
Hopefully, I didn't do anything weird.
No, I did.
No, I mean, like, the fact that my Skype video is still up. I still have pants on, don't worry. But no, I mean, behind this whole thing, we've got these three orbital command centers coming down. We're gonna have some crazy macro out of our Terran player, but what kind of, oh my gosh, 8 workers killed? Man, that's tough to start the game off with.
18 total units lost for 650 resources.
In fact, Apocalypse has a perfect game right now.
Mm-hmm.
He has not lost
the second time we've
at all.
Seen that too. Remember the game where he didn't lose a Reaper?
And yeah, I mean he had to salvage a bunker at least, but yeah. But yeah, so far no units lost, no canceling, no salvaging. Dang. So again, we have do we have an armory done yet? No.
So this is actually very dangerous for the Zerg player. Like, having the Reapers and the Hellions, they're both fast units. I mean, the Hellions are a little bit faster, but they can actually deal with this. By the way, Sinestra had to leave due to lag problems, so right here is a great push. You can focus down one, and the thing is, as a Zerg player, you don't know what the hell is actually shooting at you with this. So the Hellions protect the Reapers protect the Hellions.
Really good Zerglings surround, though.
Oh, that was a great surround, you're right.
I mean, it didn't kill off all the Hellions, but we, you know, Mini-Razor lost. Yeah, and Mini-Razor lost no drones in that fight, so that's, you know, it's a little bit of something. Mm-hmm. And he's down to kind of a little more manageable number of Hellions, and especially a couple of pretty low Hellions that can't really be so bold as to just continue to poke in. And we've got a whole bunch of Zerglings wrapping around the map to try and counterattack.
Oh, Banelings, that's some Banes. And guess what? Yeah. We've seen this before from other Terrans where you put three depots in a bunker, and guess what? That didn't hold up really well under this kind of pressure. So it looks like Apocalypse is in for
Apocalypse
a world of hurt.
Yeah, he's not ready for this at all. All of his army is on the other side of the map. There is one Banshee that's going to come back and try and defend, but Banshees just don't really kill units. I mean, they don't kill the fast ones.
It
doesn't matter. So we got Zerglings into the main base of Apocalypse. At the same time, we've got Hellions and a Reaper, or Hellions and a Reaper back into Mini Razor's base, as well as a Banshee and Mini's base. So we're coming close to some sort of base race, base trade scenario here. It's going to be who comes out with any amount of workers alive. I mean, at this point, we're down to 9 SCVs.
There's no workers left at all for Mini Razor. This attack has to win because he has no income. Neither person has an income.
Mini-Razor's got 18 workers, though, somewhere. They're just kind of hanging out.
42 SCV kills and 17 drone kills in that, like, base trade. We're looking at, like, a complete neutering of both players. I hate to say it. They've just been turned into Varys from Game of Thrones, and they are all eunuchs. And by the way, there's the 18 workers. It's at the natural of Mini-Razor. But both these guys are pretty much kind of borked.
Yeah, I mean, at this point, Mini-Razor's just gotta, like, he has to make sure he has, I guess he's got his spores up, so no Banshee, no fear of the Banshees right now, and I guess just starting to pump out Queens, and then once you get a couple of those, make your drones, and you're a happy little camper. Apocalypse does have the, I guess the benefit of having three orbital command centers. I mean, meals are good, but with only six SCBs,
yeah.
I mean, it's hard to say that it'll really give him the comeback mechanic that he really needs right now. And this one Banshee might get picked off in the main base.
Oh, it's gonna die. The other two, they go cloak and they decide that's a wasted cloak. Never do that when you don't see that there's a defense there. You cloak as soon as you see it, so they come out. They're gonna go ahead and focus on the queen, and one Banshee will kill one queen. But you know what? There's nothing like two Banshees killing one queen. They gotta focus on the spore. They can actually get this. They're out of range of the spore, which is nice. So he'll probably get this hatch, but what he really needs to do is, just pick off the spore! Well, whatever, don't pick it off, it's cool, go ahead and kill the queen, I like that too, I enjoy that. The spore goes down really fast, but the base is gonna go down, and it's gonna be two base on two base. And that's kind of where Terran wants to be. You don't want to be where the Zerg has one base ahead, and just drone killing a plenty. This one has 18, 19 kills. Holy cow. This one Banshee is a hero Banshee, 19 kills. The other one is a corporal at 7 kills. Incredible so far, Kevin. I mean, like, this has to hurt as a Zerg player, by the way.
Yeah, no, it's a super uncomfortable spot to be in, because it just feels like you're like kind of limited by, can I just get queens out or something? Like, and Mini-Razor keeps getting them picked off and not really able to maintain a queen count. He might get the one Banshee.
Literally 2 hit points. 2.
Oh no.
Oh, no.
What
no.
if Hero Spore. Oh.
Oh, that was so close. Oh, that was so close. You know what? That's the only time I actually wanted the Banshee to die. Like, that would have been just like epic.
Yeah.
In the meantime, you know, let's take a look at this, the status of Terran. So he's got
some back
Marines.
To 29 SCVs.
And that's not bad. I mean, like, if you look at the worker count, like, the worker count is
now, it's good.
It's better. I mean, he's still down 6, but I compared to the fact that he had, like, what, 6, like, a couple of minutes ago?
He had 4. When all was said and done, he had 4 SCVs.
Yeah.
And, yeah.
Oh,
he
you
has
know why? He made a third command center. That's why. He was pumping SCVs out of that. Mm-hmm. So, okay, I got a question. So what does the Zerg player do in this position to win? What can he do with what he has?
At one point in time, I was going to say go for, like, a quick spire, but after losing that third base, it's still real hard. Ah, gosh, it is real hard.
Like,
I mean,
what is your next move? If you this is you playing, Nivek, what do you do? What do you do to try to put pressure on to do something after that ridiculous Banshee attack? And those Banshees are still alive. I mean, 22 yeah. kills by one and 10 by the other. 32 kills for these two Banshees.
I think, I guess it has to be really just defending with a decent amount of Banelings and Zerglings, which we are seeing Minirays able to do right now. I mean, like, your Spire is just nowhere near early enough. You're not going to have enough Mutas to really take on this many Marines that are coming down with +1/+1 weapons and armor. And yeah, so you kind of just need to defend with Banelings, but the third base... very likely candidate for getting taken out yet again.
It's not just a candidate. I'm pretty certain he got accepted to the school of Onage.
Yeah, that is a very... I mean, at this point, I think it's... I mean, if you...
23, 12. Oh my god, the Hero Banshee, the commander level Banshee, is still alive. No, don't die! Oh, the commander dies, leaving only his sergeant in charge. And this is one amazing push. There were literally 35 kills between that. The Marine control is beyond amazing, and wow! Apocalypse now has taken 2-1.
I my Zerg heart can't handle this right now, man. Like,
oh,
it's just
my. Oh.
The
right,
power of meals compels you, man. Like, holy cow.
Oh, hold on. I'm gonna go ahead and say, you know what, here? Before we get into the next game, let's go ahead and I'm gonna take a quick bio break. Do you need a break?
I mean, I'm good. I don't know.
Alright,
at least I'd say at least get into well, I don't know. We'll see.
Let's see here. 2 minutes? Let's see here. I'm typing in the chat. Oh, he went to go. He thinks he's a map hack.
No, I mean, it's a joke, I think.
Oh, maybe. I don't know. You know what? I'll just.
Anyway, go. Right, go.
Okay, so hold on. 2 minutes for casters.
Yep.
Break for casters. BRB. All right, I'm going to go ahead and put a little music on. Sorry, it's the same song, but I'm using a theme tonight. So you guys get to listen to this. I'll go ahead and turn the game music off so you guys can at least listen to this. I will be right back. I'm DJ Spectre. I'm going to let Nivek here go ahead and talk and cover this for whatever it's worth, and I'll be right back.
All right, so I guess it's so difficult because there is a 2 or 3 minute delay, I think. So such is life, but chat. How do we feel about... Well, I guess I'm watching this game go on right now, but how do we feel about this game? I mean, Apocalypse went down to 4 SCVs. I saw it. I seen it. There were 4 SCVs against... I guess it was only like 20-some drones of Mini Razor, but man, that was some crazy control out of those Banshees, some really good, you know... good positioning on them as well. He barely lost any Banshees. I mean, he had the 3 and he lost 1 at some point in time, but managed to keep those 2 and really do some great work with them. Man, it's just, I don't know, as a player, just like, it makes me just feel so like, so my heart is broken. I don't know, like, how you could really get out of that. I guess it really, I mean, I think really if there was like a couple more spores, I think there are no spores in Mini Razor's main base. Something like that.
There was no spores in that base. It was the only one that didn't have a spore.
Yeah, and then, I mean, it just like, with some good jumping back and forth between the Banshees by Apocalypse, who's just able to keep the pressure on the whole time and continue to get drone kills and queen kills. And, you know, Mini Razor kept trying, you know, it started out looking like he was in a good place. He was able to, you know, be able to recover more quickly than Apocalypse was, but through some heroic Banshees, who hopefully they got ejected from their ship as it went down, and they were able to go back to, you know, into an early retirement.
Like those guys, like those two women in those Banshees, like they deserve like medals of honor, like a beach house in Belize, you know, whatever, the whole nine. And by the way, I'm gonna go ahead and say that we're ready to go. Casters are ready.
Yep. So we
all right. It looks like Mini Razor is still attempting to join the party, so there may be some issues.
Yeah.
So we're still waiting for him to come back in line.
All right, Mini Razor's back. I think we are ready to go. Looks like we're going into Iron Fortress. Nice.
Alright. You know what, the next song, because that will be the next match, could potentially be a game winner, right? So Apocalypse now only needs one more match to win. And so, at the end of this stream, I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and here, we'll go into... By the way, I want to tell you, since this could be a game winner here, by the way, I'm DJ Spectre. Go ahead and follow me on Twitter at DJ Spectre TV. The guy below me on the stream here, that is Nivik706. Go ahead and give him a follow on his stream. He actually volunteered. Otherwise, I'd be solo casting this, and no one wants to look at only my face this entire time. The funny hats is because we just did the Midwest Cup like a while ago, and I don't know how it started, but I'm wearing a sombrero, I'm drinking Tecate, and he's wearing a Christmas tree costume that used to glow.
I don't know why what I've done with my life right now. I swear I have a real job and I'm not just this crazy person that lives in a basement.
Well, you did mention it's in your bedroom, so you know, we'll see.
Well, yeah, I mean,
Slivers HD, welcome to the chat. Haven't seen you in forever. Good to see you. You know, Slivers was one of my very first viewers ever when I first started my stream. He and I played like Need for Speed and StarCraft, and what did we do? Titanfall was the other one we played, so very cool. But we'll get to that in a second. Currently, actually now looking to win this series after some amazing Banshee play in the last game. It's our Teal Terran player. His name's Apocalypse, and he's right here.
And then our Swedish Zerg player spawning up in the top left-hand side of this map. I think he is down 1-2 in this best of five, so he has to win the next two matches without dropping one in order to win this to get first place in this tournament and the whole prize pool. He is Mini Razor. It is 2-1, right?
Yeah, it is. Apocalypse won the last two.
Yep. Nice.
So, yeah, I agree. I agree. Descended won a longer game. It'd be awesome. But that last one was pretty intense, though. I mean, you gotta admit, like some of these matches, they just don't live up to the hype. Like, for example, one of the recent tournaments I casted ended with a failed cannon rush, and then the other player just rage quitting. So there's that. And at least we don't have that right now, right?
It happens sometimes. You know?
It does. So, by the way, thank you guys in the chat and on the stream. And like I said, I really, really encourage, I mean, not only go ahead and give me a follow if you like, but please give Nivek a follow also. The guy volunteered out of the blue, otherwise I'd have been solo casting this. And that solo casting, by the way, is terrible. It is literally like you feel like you belong in a padded room because you're just talking to yourself for hours and hours and hours. So
I feel like this hatchery...
That hatchery is...
No, that's right.
It's the right
I feel
time.
Like it's off by one.
Like one drone?
Or
well,
off by
no,
like
right,
one
the pool
square.
Started later than normal.
No, it just seems like it's off by a square. Maybe not. I'm crazy. Never mind. Don't mind me.
All right, go back to...
I'll be back in my corner. No. never mind. That's definitely... It's right. I'm seeing things. I'm going crazy.
You've seen too much StarCraft for one day.
the Christmas tree is getting to me.
Sorry. I forgot to turn the in-game music on, because I do that when we're not...
Yeah.
When I don't have the...
Yeah. It's the danger of swapping music, man. It's a headache. Like, for whatever reason, it's more of a headache than it feels like it should be.
Well, like, you know why it's a headache is because I'm involved, and I just make everything complicated because...
No, I've had it too before. I've gotten better at it, but like, there's times where I'm like, do I have the sound on or off? Are spamming it there, like, oh, okay, sound's enabled. I'm not an idiot.
You know what the worst part is when someone's got the sound enabled, but it's like way too loud, so like they keep hitting Control S, and you're like, you hear nothing, and then you hear bang, then nothing, then bang, then nothing, then bang. It's like, and like you're listening to it, and like your phone is distorting, your headphones are bleeding. You know, I mean, it's just. It's a disaster. However, there's a Reaper that's doing bang, bang, bang of its own, and this is why I mention it, because I don't want to hear this gunfire at 900 decibels.
Yeah, so no... Whoa! Another backup Reaper. Huh?
The backup Reaper. It's like it's the backup dancer, so which one's going to take Britney Spears?
I thought it was like an SCV coming in for the bunker, but... So no bunker rushing going on, but certainly a good number of Reapers. I mean,
this is his build. This is what he does against Zerg. Like, I wonder if he pulls this crap against Protoss.
Probably not as much, right? I mean, I don't know. I could see him maybe doing like early Reapers before a Mothership Core gets out or something like that, or before a Stalker.
Well,
even.
I think part of the reason is you do this versus Zerg, because the thing is that the Stalker outranges the Reaper, right? So the thing is that you can do that very easily. And he gets the second Queen up, but he doesn't realize the Reapers are still in the base. He needs to recall that Queen. Oh, he doesn't do that. And you know what? These drones are going to die. I think he's just trying to cheese his way to victory. Oh, bad. Oh, he could not get the contain on the drones. You know, he's got Zerglings out, but again, Speed's gonna finish. This is great. He's actually gonna be able to kill these Reapers, because once Speedlings are out, they outrun Reapers under all conditions. So that'll be really good. As soon as these Zerglings pop, like, I think he'll actually be able to stabilize and not lose any more units, because so far, six drones have died.
Yeah, but at this point in time, I mean, Apocalypse, he knows the timing. He knows, Speed's probably coming out, so he's gonna kind of just sneak away. And maybe these Speedlings won't actually be able to find the Reapers out on the map. So, unfortunately for Mini Razor, I mean, the Reapers are gone, but the follow-up is going to be another one of those, you know, maybe six Hellions and three Reapers, excuse me.
Yeah, that's true. We really haven't focused on here. I mean, you do see the Reaper Hellion Force building up. I mean, you see a third Command Center coming down, a Viking to go ahead and pick off Overlords. I mean, this composition is very strong as he transitions into what looks like going to be Cloak Banshee again, as he puts a Starport on the Command Center, on the Tech Lab.
It's very, like, mechanically... I think it's a very mechanically demanding Terran strategy, but it's also, like, super abusive.
Well, no, this is actually... I've done a similar build, though. I haven't executed it quite to the perfection that I'm looking at here. Mine... I tend to rush for the Hellions, and I tend to, like, go for the Banshee immediately, so I don't have the extra Reapers here to deal with counter-aggression. But this build is very safe, and part of the reason is because in order to get the factory and the reactor, you have to be constantly mining gas. Mm-hmm. Your eventual goal is like, hey, I need a starport for something. Who cares what? I just need it. And so you have to take your second gas for that. Well, after you build the starport, you have all this extra gas because you're only making, you know, Hellions basically out of it, right? So you're like, well, what do I do with the extra gas? Banshee, cloak. And it's just a very easy transition for Terran.
Yeah, it does all certainly. I mean, the money... The resource aspect of it certainly all times out quite nicely and lines up very well, which is, I mean, a sign of a good build. we'll see if Mini... I mean, this third base, he does have a lot of creep spread coming out to his third base, so that's real good. There is the second opening, though, in the back door of it. So it's going to be a little tough to... there's three openings.
Reaper Hellion coming in. Wow. He managed to move the drones, but it's just not... Well, I mean, he gets some hits off, but... Hellbats! Uh-oh, what is this? Here you go, this is where things get ugly. He has an armory. Hellbats do amazing damage versus Queens. Nice split on the Queens, though, actually, to prevent the conical damage of the Hellbats from actually doing it. Good transfuses, wow, actually amazing transfuses. He keeps several of those Queens at full health. One Queen drops, second Queen's gonna come over and drop. Banshee's over here trying to prevent the reinforcement, and oh my god, he's gonna lose all three Queens, I think.
Yeah, and I mean, without Banelings, Hellbats are real hard to actually clean up. I mean, if it was just Hellbats against Queens, yeah, you can micro, but it's Hellbats against, or Queens against Hellbats, and then some Reapers, and then another Banshee that's just going to be picking you off the whole time. And so at the end of the day, this third base, it's looking like it's going to go down.
That thing has no... Although Hellbats do next to no damage against that, so I mean, it's going to take a little longer. It's going to go down, but still, that was a long time.
Loses that Banshee too, though. That's a little. I mean, it's uncharacteristic for the Apocalypse season, but maybe he was like, whatever.
He loses all the Hellbats also. Holy cow!
Yeah, I mean, that's a little guaranteed.
Meanwhile, the other Banshee.
Never. Yeah. Meanwhile.
Ooh, good transfuse. Keeps the queen alive.
And not too many kills on that Banshee. I mean, just a couple. But that, I mean, that expansion going down is really tough. I mean, if we look at the workers right now, we've got 53
units lost and only 10. Yeah. Wow.
And we got a whole 56 SCVs now to the 50 drones of Mini Razor, and certainly an income advantage to our Terran player. He's kind of able to do a little bit of whatever he wants right now. It looks like he's going for, this is a little cheeky. He's going for like a
mass Hellion.
A mech push going on. It's just like, I've seen that. Oh,